All right. Good afternoon, everybody. It is November 4th, and today we are doing a topic on ADR alternatives with collaborative, traditional mediation, and arbitration. And we're excited to have you here with us, and we are recording this for people who are stuck in court right now, in person or otherwise. I have three fabulous panelists today who are experts in their respective areas of ADR alternatives, and multiples of them have done various types of ADR alternatives, not just the one that they've been assigned for purposes of the day. So I'm really looking forward to hearing feedback from everybody to the extent that you've done more than one type of ADR. So to start with, Jim Harrington is logging on. He had a little computer crash problem, so he'll be on in a minute. So I'll save Jim to last. Randy Velzen is a family law attorney in Grand Rapids. He was the founder of the Collaborative Divorce for Professionals of West Michigan and is still a member of that organization. So that's really excellent. I know he's done a lot of work in the collaborative area, which is why I asked him to join us. And I'm sure we need to get a lot more educated on how to use the process. Randy is also a current council member for the family law section. Then we have Veronique Liem, who is a family law attorney in Ann Arbor. And I originally met Veronique because we were both on council together many, many years ago. She's also a fellow of the American Academy of Matrimonial Lawyers, and she's involved in some collaborative work as well in the Collaborative Practice Institute of Michigan. But she's here today to talk about traditional mediation, and she's been fully trained, obviously, as a family law mediator. And lastly, but not least, Jim, who's going to be joining us in just a second, is Jim Harrington. He is an attorney in Novi. He is a past chair of the family law section, and he's also a fellow of the American Academy of Matrimonial Lawyers. Jim's going to be covering arbitration, and helpful for people in the audience is Jim wrote the chapter for the Lexis Family Law Treatise. He wrote the chapter on arbitrations. That book, if you haven't seen it, he's also the editor of the entire book with colleague Anthea Papista. This is the book. Oh, it's all blurry. Sorry about that. That's because of my background. Hold on. Let me get rid of the background. And there we go. So this is the book, and it's been out for about 5 years. It's updated every year. And Jim is the editor of the book, plus he works on that one chapter on arbitration. So if you are thinking about doing arbitration, you should definitely look at his chapter. And I'm hoping we'll see him in just a few minutes to join us. And Delaney from my office is keeping tabs on him to make sure he's getting on okay. So with that, what we're gonna do today is talk about these three different forms of ADR. And I'm gonna start by having each of our three panelists talk for 5 to 7 minutes about the device they've been assigned for purposes of today, what it is, how it works. If you could also please mention if there's any statutes or court rules that are relevant to your assigned area for today. And I have a lot of questions out there that I wanna ask all three of you. I also wanna remind the audience that we can do chat. You can chat to everybody in the room. You can send a chat just to the panelists if you wanna have a question that only the panelists see. And there's also a Q&A function down at the bottom of your screen. You can ask a Q&A. And I do try to keep track of that during the course of our webinar. If for some reason we don't get to your question, don't worry, we do try to answer everything, even if it's after the fact by email. So you guys are funny. I'm watching the chat. I don't know if Veronique and Randy are. So anyway, so welcome everybody, first of all, and thank you to Veronique and Randy and soon to Jim, who'll be with us in a minute. So let's go ahead and start. I didn't really assign who's going first, but let's go ahead and start with Veronique, who's doing traditional mediation today.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. And I hope some of you have already tried mediation. I think in defining mediation, I would say that it's a process where there is a neutral mediator whose goal is to have the parties reach a settlement. That's a simple way of putting it. There's different ways a mediator will operate. There's the facilitative mediation, which is a very hands-off kind of mediation. I generally don't go in that kind of mediation, and as a mediator, I am more of the other kind, which is more directive and provides feedback to the parties about the risks and opportunities and creative ways they can resolve their case. The reason I think I prefer that is because I think the feedback that a neutral qualified mediator provides is very important in helping people reach a resolution, and one of the main benefits in my view of mediation as compared to other processes. There's also some possible hybrid ways of doing mediation. For example, on certain issues where, certain issues could be resolved with attorneys present and some not. For example, if the parties are pretty close on their parenting time arrangement, but they still have issues, it may not be that important for the attorneys to be at the mediation. It depends. And maybe like for personal property, same thing. Maybe they can work with the mediator on that. Especially if you're like me and you don't like really dealing with the personal property splits. In terms of the facilitative type of mediation, I think it has a lot of value when the parties are proceeding alone without counsel, because they need more of a progression. But if counsels are present, I think the feedback is particularly important. There are court rules which are relevant to mediation. There's the standard mediation court rule, MCR 3.216. But there's also, as part of the collaborative process, and I assume Randy will talk more about that, there's been some amendment of court rules, and there's been a couple new court rules, 3.222 and 3.223, that are also relevant to mediation, especially 3.223. So 3.223 provide a summary proceeding approach when you have done mediation prior to filing a case, for example, and reached an agreement. So you can proceed with a summary proceeding for entry of a consent judgment and related court orders. You also file your case as party A and party B as opposed to plaintiff or defendant. You file a petition where the parties request entry of the judgment. Both of them have to sign. Both of them have to provide answers to a domestic violence questionnaires. The standard requirements for filing a case apply, verified statement if there's minor children and so on. The party also need to sign a waiver of the 6 months waiting period if they want that. And both of them should sign it. I don't know if you want, I may have reached my 5 minutes here, Liisa. I don't know if you want me at this point to talk about pros and cons, or is that something that you want to reserve?
That is a good question. I definitely want to cover the pros and cons. Why don't we go to Randy next, and we'll come back to the pros and cons in a minute.
Okay.
Well, first of all, Liisa, thank you for putting this on. I am a bit challenged when we talk about describing the process. I mean, I see Matt Kobliska and Deb Burris are on. Deb is one of the co-trainers in PRISM that we have done about 6 trainings or so for basic collaborative. I also relied fairly heavily on a Family Law Institute presentation by Sue Keener, who is also one of our trainers, and Carlo Martina. So I think I am guessing that some folks in the audience are very familiar with the process and other ones perhaps are very unfamiliar. So anyway, my background, just so you know, I was also on the committee that helped draft the new court rule 3.222. I lobbied for the enactment of the Uniform Collaborative Law Act, which is MCL 691-1331. So I've been really, I will say, heavily involved, and I think that collaborative process is the best process for a lot of cases, not all cases. It takes a rethinking of the advocate role for attorneys to participate. It's been said, collaborative is not negotiating with a smile on your face. It's more than that. It's looking at the whole family and helping people get through the process. The ideal couple for collaborative are the ones that come into our office and say, I just want to be fair. I don't want this to be ugly. And then we can help them sort out what's fair and what's not fair and the norms and how does it fit with their case. Two fundamental parts of the collaborative process is one, a participation agreement. The Uniform Collaborative Law Act has a fairly lengthy section on what has to be included in that participation agreement. One of the things that it needs to be included is what we call the disqualification provision. So if people sign a participation agreement, get attorneys involved and a team, and I'll talk about that in a minute, what they are agreeing that if a case falls out of process, if it's voluntary to get into the collaborative process, either party can withdraw up until the time the judgment's entered for no reason. But if they do, then all the professionals have to leave the team and they have to go restart. Some people see that as a weakness. Oh, you know, they want to have me like they're the only attorney in the world that can handle this case. And I see it as a real strength because almost always, sometimes the going gets tough. And if you can just say, oh, forget it, I'm going to go have the judge decide, that's too easy. So it really keeps people at the table. I recall a client a month ago telling me, you know, I just want the judge to decide. I don't want a trial and all that. I just want the judge to decide, which gives you an idea of how people's thinking is that, oh, we'll just walk into court and the judge will decide it. Collaborative was started by Stu Webb. I can never remember whether it was Minnesota or Wisconsin, but one of those two states. He is still around. He really developed this whole process, very thoughtful, very thorough. And what the model is you have two attorneys and you have a coach. The coach is a mental health person. That dynamic is difficult to balance, the dynamic of attorneys shutting up and mental health people taking charge. Usually it's the opposite. Attorneys like to take charge and mental health people like to listen. So if we can get that flipped, then the case has got a good chance of proceeding. We also have a financial specialist that helps us gather the information. Attorneys can usually get that themselves, but think about it. You've got two attorneys getting the information. Wouldn't it be a lot more efficient to have one person getting that information? So we have financial specialists. And then we have a child specialist called the voice of the child. That person may say, you know, Dad, when you show up with your girlfriend, your son really is troubled by that. And or other helps work through other issues, particularly if there's special needs for the child and how are we going to address that? So that's the overview. I look forward to talking about more of the issues. Thanks.
Thank you, Randy. And welcome, Jim. Just to catch you up, I've already introduced all three panelists. I said wonderful things about you and showed them a copy of the Lexis Family Law Treatise. FYI, I saw it in your hands.
Excellent.
And right now we're at the phase where everybody's taking 5 to 7 minutes just to kind of give us the overview of their ADR device. Yours obviously is arbitration, what it is and how it works. And then I have a whole bunch of questions to ask everybody if it hasn't already been covered in your 5 to 7 minutes. So Jim, it is you have the floor.
Thank you, Liisa. I appreciate it. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Great.
I can hear you fine.
The overview is technology is wonderful when it works and when it doesn't. You got to scramble.
Horrifying.
It really is. But eventually it all works. Arbitration is not favored by many attorneys and in significant areas in other parts of the state. Where I practice in the Tri-County area, we routinely do family law arbitration. And in the right case, it is a wonderful device. in order to solve some problems which you may have. You may have an unfriendly judge. You may have a judge who's already made critical rulings, which you may think are not in your client's best interests. You may be on an accelerated fast-track docket and have not got everything you need to do done. And going into arbitration can help you solve all those problems. One of the advantages to arbitration is that you can forum shop or judge shop in arbitration, which you can't do in our circuit courts. And one of the key takeaways here is to understand who your arbitrator is, what that arbitrator's philosophy is, and how they may react to the issues in your case. And it's critical to understand that. For example, there are some arbitrators who just don't believe in invasion of separate property. Well, if you got major separate property issues involving invasion, then you don't select that arbitrator.
Wait, how do you know, Jim, how do you know that?
You check them out. You talk to other lawyers. That's what networking is about. That's why we're members of the family law section. And if you do, and one will find that other attorneys can be very responsive if they're asked a question about, like, what do you think of so-and-so with an arbitrator? Anyone that wants to call me here in the metropolitan area and ask me about so-and-so as an arbitrator, I'll tell you what I think. And arbitrators do have, in fact, different philosophies, just like all judges do. So it's really important to evaluate and assess your arbitrator. I think it's also critical to understand the statute, which consists of 313 sections and the cases underneath it. No one should be arbitrating unless they have reviewed and understand the statutory basis for it. The most important takeaway I can give here today is your arbitration agreement is a tool. The tool is designed to protect your client. When I'm an arbitrator and someone says, could you send me your standard form arbitration agreement? I sort of chuckle because why are you giving me the power to contract between you and the other side regarding controlling the arbitrator? So craft your contract in a way that will protect you and protect your client. Make sure your contract, your arbitration agreement, is limited to the issues that you want to arbitrate. When I see an arbitration agreement that provides for, we will arbitrate spousal support, property, child support, custody, and all ancillary issues. All ancillary issues, unless you're very, very careful and very lucky, can really harm you and your client because you've given the arbitrator unlimited power and the arbitrator is controlled by the arbitration agreement. Should an arbitrator arbitrate a case if the arbitrator has also been the mediator? Answer, maybe. It depends on the facts of your case. It depends on what your buy-in of trust with the mediator is, and it depends on the reputation of the mediator arbitrator. By and large, I do not think it's unethical, like some lawyers do, for an arbitrator to have mediated the case. The flip side is you need to be smart. And if you know that a case may end up in arbitration by your mediator, you want to be careful about what you said about the limits of your settlement authority and what you can and can't do. It's pretty hard to unring a bell sometimes. One final point I would make is it's also important to understand what the philosophy of your judge is on bifurcation. Bifurcation issues in arbitration come out of YEO, Y-E-O versus Y-E-O, and which provide that the trial court has to resolve all issues. In the jurisdictions I practice in, that is not followed by many judges, fortunately. Do you really need to have all personal property and household furnishings arbitrated before you can get a judgment entered? I would argue not. And most judges are going to go along with ADR if it helps move the case along.
But Jim, an important point regarding bifurcation, even though it may not impact how the trial judge proceeds or delay the wrapping up what the trial court needs to do, it could still delay your ability to appeal by right until the bifurcated issues are resolved.
Good point. Excellent point from the appellate side. Yeah. Bottom line is, I'm a fan of arbitration in family law cases. In the right case, it gives attorneys tools in terms of flexibility and scheduling. In the areas where I practice, a trial will take place over a number of months. You can't get 2 days or 3 days consecutive days. You can't get 4 hours 1 week and 4 hours the next week. And the arbitrator can work closely with the parties and make it user friendly. Final point is, and I recommend to all attorneys, you have to have your clients understand and buy into the arbitration process. They need to know it's full, final, binding, and non-appealable, except for very, very narrow issues. And I would recommend to all attorneys, as part of the arbitration preparation, as well as your examination of your client to protect you and protect yourself, is cover their understanding of the arbitration process. Ask your client, do they understand that it's full, final, binding, and non-appealable? And they're all in agreement with that until the final arbitration award comes in. And then they say, oh, well, I never agreed to that. So it's really important to protect yourself and to protect your client as well and make them part of the process. Have them understanding before they go in why you're going in and what your objectives are. And a lot of times clients are very unhappy because they say they never understood that. Well, maybe, maybe not, but make a record on that.
Thank you. I've heard the same thing from clients with respect to a settlement agreement that is reached at mediation. And, you know, they have, whether it's buyer's remorse 3 days later, they're panicking. I didn't understand what I was agreeing to, but it happens all the time for whatever reason. I would like if each of you could address what kinds of cases are the most suitable for each type of ADR device. And Randy, you already told us about the ideal couple. So if you have anything more to add, feel free. But what types of cases are the most suitable for mediation, collaborative, or arbitration? Veronique?
Yeah, I mean, it's to some extent, there's a parallel between the suitable cases for collaborative and mediation. I mean, you have to be careful when you have a case that involves domestic violence or undue control by one spouse over the other. That can be a problematic situation. And frankly, as a mediator, you have to have the parties complete the domestic violence questionnaire, but it's a limited piece of information. I think it's definitely important to have it, but there may be a need for a more thorough questioning of the parties, at least by their attorneys, before proceeding. And if there is this kind of imbalance or even prior violence, on the violence side, you don't want to do it unless the parties really want to proceed. In terms of imbalance of powers, you definitely want to have attorneys present. And if they're not present and you realize that this is happening, it's better to stop the mediation and request for the attorneys to come. So what was the question again?
So the question is, what type of case is most suitable for mediation?
So most suitables would be pretty much the other cases. Mm. I think if there's some serious mental health issues on the part of a party, I would say proceed with caution as well. The more problematic the case, the more important it is for attorneys to be present. It's also probably wise to not try to push the case into a settlement too quickly. It may be that if a case has some issues in terms of the party's mental health or a bit of an imbalance, it might be good to try to keep shorter sessions and have them a bit over time. So there is an opportunity to explain things to the client, to address issues. So I would say those cases are a bit of a red flag. And I would say all the other cases probably could be mediated.
And we will talk more about domestic violence in a little bit. So I'm gonna turn now to Randy. And if you already answered the question about the ideal couple, but is there any other types of cases that make a case more suitable for collaborative before it becomes a case, obviously?
Well, and I think we'll talk about costs and whether that's a disadvantage. I don't sell collaborative because it's cheaper. It isn't. It depends what you compare it to. If you compare it to a long drawn out litigation, it's almost always cheaper. If you compare it to a mediated case, where people come in for a session or two, it's going to be more expensive than that. So the couple needs to have some financial resources to sort of do it right, in my opinion. But otherwise, we say that collaborative is a cousin of mediation, and it's pretty much the same analysis that Veronique just did. Thank you.
Okay, Rand, Jim?
A particular case that I think is very, very appropriate for arbitration is a case where there may be some issues regarding unreported income, tax fraud, and the like. The parties haven't settled on those issues. So do you want the judge, when he hears the proofs about unreported income or two sets of books and the like, do you want the judge making a referral to the IRS or the federal prosecutor? Those cases are very dangerous cases. There's lots of professional negligence pitfalls for attorneys when you've got potential criminal issues involved. To me, that's an ideal case for an arbitration because I don't think the arbitrator has the obligation to report. Maybe they do, maybe they don't. I haven't seen anything on it. I also think that cases where you're down to one or two issues, be it property or spousal or child support and inherited property, if you can narrow the issues in the case and present the arbitrator with a relatively narrow focus, that's an ideal case for arbitration. And I think the worst kind of case for arbitration is where nothing has been settled in the principal case and everything is on the table. I think that's very challenging for the arbitrator. Not that it can't be done, but I think it's very challenging for the parties too. So if you've got, if it's a wide open case and everything's on the table, wow, that's a ball of twine, which probably will not unravel easily. There's going to be a mess at the end.
Jim, you mentioned several types of cases. And in my experience, I've observed that most of the cases I see to go to arbitration are more high asset or money cases. Do you not recommend them for custody? Is that more disfavored to have custody cases sent to arbitration?
It really depends on my judge. If I know that the judge has a particular philosophy, or I know the judge is not going to have enough time to allow us to develop the issues, then there's no reason why arbitration can't work, because the arbitrator will give the parties and the attorneys as much time as they need to present their proofs and will schedule conveniently for the parties and can get it done, in my view, in many cases, not all, none of this is one size fits all, but in many cases, the arbitrator can be more efficient and more cost effective, even though the trial court is not charging an hourly and the arbitrator is. But if it takes you 3 months to try a case, or 4 months or 5 months, which happens, then aren't you better off getting it done in 30 days in front of an arbitrator?
Right. Oh,
one other case, Liisa, I do want to mention is that where you have a significant income disparity between the parties, and one party is in a position to kick this up to the appellate court for years, arbitration, because of the narrow level of judicial review, in most cases will get the case done and take away the uneven leverage in terms of economics and ability to pay attorney fees. And that's another reason. It doesn't have to be a high asset case to arbitrate, however.
Right. Okay, thank you. So I'm going to, my next question for everybody on the panel is really going to be two questions in one. And can you share with us the success rates you've seen in the specific type of ADR device that you're covering today? And also if you have any comments at all about cost benefit analysis, Veronique?
Well, from my own experience, both ways, as a mediator or as an attorney going to a mediator, I say the success rates are well above 90%.
I'm sorry, 90?
Yeah.
Wow.
But that's my own sample of cases, which is a fairly good size sample. I would say, I just want to say something in relation to Jim's comment about the custody going to arbitration on a custody case when there's issues. What I like to do in the context of mediation or otherwise is to have a mental health professional act as a child specialist and work with the parties outside of even the attorneys being involved, I mean, with communications, but to try to help the parties come to a parenting arrangement. And if you have a very good person, they're not easy to find, but some of them are extremely helpful in getting the parties to agree. I've had two or three cases recently where the parties started off, one wanted 50-50, the other didn't want 50-50. And then some mental health professional worked with the parties, talked about the needs of the child or the children, given their age, and maybe even talked to the children. And eventually the parties were able to reach a parenting plan in that context. So that's also a component of mediation, which makes it quite desirable.
So,
and then if it doesn't work, you go to arbitration with Jim.
the percent you gave, Veronique, is quite high, 90%. That's your own personal rate. I know there's a lot of people in the audience who have either experienced mediation on behalf of their clients or have been trained as mediators and serve as mediators. If you don't mind, if you just have your own observation from either end about how successful you've seen mediation, just put it a chat to everyone so we can just see some numbers. And I'm not, it doesn't even have to be associated with you. It could just be like in your, you know, anecdotal experience, this is what you think is the success rate from the cases you've, you know, seen or worked on. Anyway, that would be, I think, really helpful. And then Randy, success rates and cost benefit analysis. And you sort of did cover some of this already, so don't necessarily repeat anything you've already talked about.
All right. Well, I'm sitting here being an attorney and thinking about the definition of success, right?
Is that when you get paid, Randy?
Partially.
Yeah, it is successful. Yep. If a couple goes to a collaborative and they resolve the parenting time and custody issues but can't get over the hump on a property settlement, is that successful or not? There is some success there. As we get better, I was trained in 2016. Is that right? 2006, I think. Yeah.
It wasn't 16.
No. Because the UCLA was enacted in 2014. So 2006. And as we got better in figuring out who could do this, the success rate, of course, went up. When we started, we had a couple successful, there was about a handful of us. We had regular meetings and we had a couple successful cases. It isn't as great. Everybody needs to do collaborative. Well, that was a mistake. And so we had a lot of people fall out of process is what the lingo is, fall out of process. But I think we're about 90% successful that get to the finish line of a judgment being entered. Cost benefit. I think it is worth the sometimes it costs more, sometimes it costs more, but the end product is people are together on the same page when it comes to parenting, when it comes to feeling like they were fair and respectful to the other side. So that is worth, in my book, the extra costs that it sometimes take. But I don't want to say it's always out of the world expensive, because I don't feel that either. So I think you get what you pay for to some degree. Everybody says it's pretty easy to get how much child support. You plug the numbers in and you get the answer. And collaborative folks kind of waver on that a little bit. I make a habit when I'm out of the state to ask other attorneys, how do you decide child support? And it's all over the board. So this isn't, you know, a message from God that our child support formula is the best thing in the world. But we come to a number, but the other part of the child support, which nobody knows, is what does that child support cover? And that's where you don't get that discussion very often in litigation. Mediation you can, and collaborative you can. So that's an advantage that I say is worth the extra cost. Sometimes it costs extra, sometimes it doesn't. Thank you.
Thank you, Randy. And there's a lot of people who are giving us feedback on the chat about their success with mediation. And it's like, it seems to be wildly successful. If you have any thoughts about the success rates in your experience, audience, for collaborative, feel free to share them as well. This is very enlightening for me. Jim, arbitration, success rates, cost-benefit analysis?
Well, I think the success rate would probably be how many arbitration cases end up getting reversed in the Court of Appeals. So probably 98% of arbitration cases are successful because it's so hard to get a reversal in an arbitration case.
So what about the fact that somebody files not the errors and omissions, but when they do a motion to set aside the arbitration in the trial court. Is that
really
still
hard to, it's really hard to prevail on that unless the arbitrator has varied from the terms of the arbitration agreement. That one's pretty easy if they've gone off into left field and that was not within their powers. But by and large, attorneys should assume and conclude that the arbitration award is going to be enforceable. I want to comment on the mediation success rates. I agree with like all of the comments that are coming in. Mediation, I think, is successful in the first instance in 70 to 80% of cases. And if I've got a case that I haven't settled and I find out later on it's settled, often it follows the pattern that I had suggested or recommended or discussed with the party. So it might not settle that day, but it may very well settle, which puts the cases I've seen up in the 90% range in terms of how many settle versus how many go to trial. One comment I do want to make though, and this is from my experience. When I hear about mediation cases that settled at quote 11 o'clock at night, the night before the trial, something's really wrong with that process. No client should have to sit in a mediation until 11 o'clock at night, the night before the trial. And I really think, and what I've tried to implement in my practice, and I throw this out there just as a potential tip, is I don't want an 8-hour mediation. I want to mediate a case either as mediator or with my client for no more than 4 hours. And I want a mediator who can get me back in a week or 2 weeks later in order to have a second or third mediation session. Some cases cannot be settled in a day. Some can't be settled in two sessions. But most cases, if there's a commitment to settlement, will settle. But I just don't believe in an 8 or 9 or 10 hour marathon mediation session. I used to, but that was then. And now I want to be fresh at the end of the mediation session. I want to be able to type up my notes. And I want to look forward to the next mediation session with my clients. And there's no reason that you can't limit the length of a mediation in advance. So that's a practical tip.
I was going to quibble with one thing that you said, Jim.
Of course.
I question whether I would call an arbitration a success if somebody ends up appealing it, regardless of what the Court of Appeals does, because then you still have to go through the process of appeal and have the lack of finality. I mean, and part of the reason that people do arbitration is to avoid all of that. So if it gets to that point where somebody's appealing, I don't know that I would call it a success, but that's just, you know, my thought. Randy.
Yeah, Jim, I'm back to thinking about what success is. You know, maybe.
Attorneys.
you gotta love them. Actually, I think if you could look at that, the participants, the parties, a year down the road, are they recommending that process to their friends who are getting divorced or not? That, to me, would be whether it's successful or not.
Fair point, Randy. Okay, so we have some questions from the audience, and I know I have a list of other questions that I was, you know, planning on asking you, but I do want to get to the audience questions first if I can. So we have, and I'm going to say names because it might help give context about what part of the state they're in. So Tom Chadwick, I believe, is still in Ionia County, just west of Lansing, and he's asking about the best time to engage in ADR when the friend of court is trying to quickly enter a temporary order. Obviously, that's beyond the collaborative state at that point, such as under the Fig C under MCR 3224. When is the best time? Is it earlier the better, just to avoid having to deal with a friend of court process? So anybody can answer.
Well, I think I do a lot of mediation early in a case. And so if there's some concern about getting a recommendation from the friend of the court, that might be a good place to have mediation before you get it. I mean, it may be a mediation of interim issues, but that happens quite a bit. I mean, people want to separate. They need to figure out their finance, the kids' schedule. If they separate, it's almost like it can be a pretty intense and a productive type of mediation.
Okay, Kristen Robinson had a little bit of a long question regarding arbitrating judgment language. So if she's, I hope she hears this, I'm allowing her to talk. I think I've never done this before, actually. I don't know where she went.
Hey, Kristen,
can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Excellent. Kristen, why don't you go ahead and ask your question rather than me just reading it?
Sure. So I feel like this has come up quite a bit lately where I'm mediating a case and the attorneys ask that the mediator is appointed as arbitrator as to judgment language. So it's, you know, they've settled the case. Now they're trying to draft a judgment and issues come up. And so they want the mediator to arbitrate those disputes. So typically it's not an issue and everyone agrees and you have a phone conference or a quick Zoom meeting. But lately I've had a couple of cases where the issues are really not judgment language. They kind of extend beyond what words mean into more substantive things that maybe were for the parties forgot at mediation or were overlooked. And there's no order at that point, you know, for arbitration because they just went to mediation. The judgment hasn't been entered that has that standard arbitration language in it yet. And so I'm just wondering, you know, how those of you who arbitrate, Jim, how you handle that? Do you have to enter into a separate arbitration agreement for those post-judgment issues if it gets beyond a certain point? And have you had to deal with this, or is this just like a recent COVID?
Well, I have had mediation agreement either in the recorded form or printed form, but usually recorded, where there is an agreement, because it's usually at the end of a mediation when you have an agreement that the mediator will arbitrate the provisions that are in dispute. Am I misunderstanding your question?
So it's like the case is settled. Either there's a written settlement agreement or a recorded settlement agreement.
And
the attorneys are drafting a judgment, and they cannot agree to the language in the judgment. They think that one of them thinks that the settlement meant A, and the other one thinks the settlement meant B, and then they come back to the mediator to say, "Okay, you tell us." Well, if everybody agrees, I suppose that what the mediator slash arbitrator says goes, then it's a non-issue. But if you have somebody who says, no, it's just come up recently. And I'm just wondering, you know, from a statutory standpoint, I don't think there's any authority because the parties didn't enter into an arbitration agreement for those issues. There's no order for arbitration. But I think, I mean, in where I practice, this is common. Attorneys do this. They say, okay, mediator, we're appointing you as binding arbitrator for judgment language. And
that is really a tricky issue. And I think there's significant malpractice exposure to attorneys who agree to simply that broad language. My recommendation is if you're going to agree to that, which is common over here in this jurisdiction, you want to have some additional clarifying language there as to what the powers of the mediator quasi arbitrator are, specifically that the mediator acting as arbitrator on judgment language does not have the power to rule upon substantive issues and only as to implementation of the settlement, for example. But it's a slippery slope, and it can be very difficult because there are attorneys out there, fortunately a small number, who view a settlement agreement as just an invitation to renegotiate. So the more clarifications, the more guidance you can provide to the mediator acting as arbitrator on what kind of language are they going to be interpreting. And for example, if there shall be adequate security for the obligations under this agreement. Well, some of my favorite lawyers have 6 pages single space of security agreements. And the other side may not have had that in mind. And you're really getting into substantive issues. And the long and the short of it is, at some point, if it's a substantive issue that you want the mediator to resolve, it's not a judgment language issue. It's, do you have a settlement in the case? And at some point, the settlement may break down because you can't agree on that. Now, at that point, probably cooler heads will prevail and they'll find a way to work around that language. But that's an area of exposure to attorneys who act as mediators and then quasi arbitrators on judgment language. That's my comment.
Thank you, Kristen, for the question. I'm going to go ahead and mute you again. We have two topics. We have a lot of topics that we could cover, but there's two more things we have to cover today before we end at 2 o'clock, and they may be somewhat interrelated. The first one we already mentioned very briefly is domestic violence screening when it comes to using any of these ADR devices. And I know, Veronique, you commented on it, and if there was domestic violence concerns, you know, that mediation was not an appropriate mechanism, but can each of you address, you know, what the attorneys and what the person in charge of the session, whether it's an arbitrator, a collaborative, or mediator, should be doing? Help us out understand, like, how to make sure we're not putting a domestic violence victim in a tenuous, position. Veronique, do you have any more to add than what you had said previously?
Yeah, I would say I think the asking the parties to complete the domestic violence screening protocol is a minimum. I think even for the mediator, I think especially if there's anything other than a series of no, I think the mediator should perhaps have a meeting with both parties. In fact, I often like to have a meeting with both parties separately to just get a bit more information. It doesn't have to be a very long meeting, but maybe 15 minutes with each party or whatever is needed, but it usually doesn't take a huge amount of time to get to their level of comfort, to get to some issues that are particularly important to them. I think that's helpful. The attorney certainly can attend it too or not, as they prefer. I think the attorney also have to really talk to their clients before mediation and determine whether it is a case where mediation is suited. And in addition to that, to prepare the client about what mediation is about, what the role of everybody is, and also when it becomes binding, and so on.
Lisa,
I muted myself. Yeah, go ahead.
Lisa, I have a comment on the domestic violence. I have a questionnaire, which is basically check the boxes, which is 5 pages, double spaced, where before I will do any mediating on that case. I want that DV questionnaire filled out. And I want it signed not just by the client, but by the attorney. I don't want the client to have said something to their counsel and the attorney is not signing that disclosure either. I want both the attorney to sign that disclosure and I want the party to do it as well. And without that, I don't know how you can proceed, but I do have sort of a contrarian view as well. There are some cases where going to trial can be as traumatic as an ADR alternative. And yeah, I'm going to drag you down to the courthouse and then we're going to take you through everything that ever happened. I think that can be abusive. And now in Zoom, I think there's less risk on the DV end where we have parties in actually separate offices, not the same courtroom, not staring at each other down the hallway. How many times have we seen those stares and that intimidation? That's one of the positive benefits, I think, of Zoom is that it has made it more user-friendly for everyone, including victims of real or threatened domestic violence.
Let me jump in a little bit here. Clearly, it's an obligation under the Uniform Collaborative Law Act for attorneys to investigate domestic violence in collaborative cases. How well are we doing that? It depends on the practitioner. To speak to, on mediation a second, I think we're finally getting people, mediators, to where they should be, that they're going to investigate that. For years, I would hear, oh, I just leave that up to the attorneys. Well, most attorneys don't do any investigation on DV unless the client brings it up. So that's not reliable. When I was on the Kent County ADR Oversight Committee, I suggested that there be a line in the reports that we have to file when the DV screening took place. I thought maybe at least if they
had to answer the question. Yeah,
they at least had to confront the fact that they weren't doing what they should be doing. So I think
that's a great idea.
I think the bar is getting more sensitive to the issue, thank goodness.
And also there's the Pullman case where the Court of Appeals upheld the mediation agreement despite the lack of a screening. However, I think it went to the Supreme Court, who remanded it to the Circuit Court, I believe, and I don't know where it's at. But I think it is not a resolved issue. I think if there has not been proper screening, we may see cases that are a bit more compelling than this one, even go back to appeals.
I think, Veronique, what happened, and I'm sure somebody will correct me if I'm wrong in the chat, it went to the Supreme Court, who remanded it to do a evidentiary hearing on the DV screening issue. I believe, and this is not a case I worked on, but I believe that the trial court made a finding that the screening did happen. So there was a question about it in the first appeal, went up, Supreme Court's like, we want to know the answer to this, which I think is a good indication that they're going to start holding attorneys' feet to the fire, that, you know, this is an important part of the process. And you need to, you know, even if it's like what Randy said, checking the box and telling us what you did to do your DV screening, or having your form that Jim talked about completed, I think maybe we're going to see, you know, this is, I think, a signal to us that we need to make sure we're doing it. And it sounds like it did happen in the case, at least as I understand it. One more question for me. And I did want to point out, one of our audience members, Alyssa Peskin Shepherd, pointed out that there's a training coming up in January that we want to make sure everybody knows about. It's the Collaborative Practice Institute of Michigan has a basic training coming up in January on the 27th and 28th of January, 2022. So I'm hoping, if she has a link to that, she can post it in the chat, but I want to make sure everybody here today knew about that collaborative basic training session. And then my last question that we have to get to, and I do have more questions we can ask, but it's come up actually multiple times today in the chat, and it was already on my list of questions. I definitely want to address it. The comment was about using Zoom for any of these ADR devices. And a lot of our audience members have been commenting that the success rates have gone down during Zoom times, and maybe they're also taking longer. They were specifically talking about mediation, as far as I can tell. So if everybody could address, how has Zoom impacted the type of device you're working with? I would love to have the feedback. I'll go ahead again and start with Veronique.
Yeah, I mean, I think generally speaking, it works pretty well for mediation with the breakout room. It has an element of convenience. It provides a wider geographical range for selecting mediator without worrying about the travel. And so it's an opportunity to really choose your mediators based on the need of the case and trying to optimize that, because as I mentioned, I think the feedback of the mediator is an important component here. I think the downside of Zoom is for those more complicated psychological cases where the parties can be very entrenched. It's harder to influence a client through a screen than in the same room, and the same for the mediator. It's harder to come through with the screen. So I think it's for those really difficult cases, not necessarily difficult in terms of the issues, but the emotions. And, you know, for example, the feeling of maybe entitlement, the feeling I'm right about this. That's where Zoom is a bit less effective, I think, than the human contact of being there. And it's not as much fun. I mean, it is nice to have, you know, in mediation, you do meet attorneys and mediator, and you have a bit of a chat, and it's harder to do on Zoom.
But Veronique, one of the great advantages of Zoom is that now somebody on the east side of state can work with somebody on the west side of state if they think that person's going to be the best suit of the case, or vice versa, obviously. Randy.
I've done a number of cases with Zoom, collaborative cases, and they've gone all right. There are some advantages, of course, to now no travel and flexibility with time. Overall, if I had my druthers, I'd rather have it be in person. One of the goals in a collaborative process is to help people learn how to communicate in their new relationship, particularly if there's kids. And that's easier modeled and done when everybody's sitting in the same room as opposed to being on Zoom. So I'm not, I wouldn't stop, I wouldn't not take a case because it was Zoom. I think it works. I don't think it's ideal.
Jim thinks that there are trade-offs, that there's no one-size-fits-all rule. I think we're getting better at what we do, both as mediators in Zoom and as advocates in Zoom. We're now comfortable with what we're doing, and we're getting away from getting hung up on the technology. As a mediator, there's nothing more important to me than actually being in the room with an attorney and their client and watch the nonverbal communication, watch the responses, listen to the tones that are there. And that's invaluable to me. The flip side is so much of our mediations involve dead time, and dead time in a mediation in my office is much more productive if there's other things I can be working on, rather than spending in a 4-hour mediation, spending 2 hours in another lawyer's office, and I can't do anything. I can't make anything happen. I'm just sitting there running, watching the clock go. So I think Zoom can be very helpful. It can be a trade-off, but it really depends on the personalities of the parties and the attorneys.
That's true also for the attorney. I mean, as an attorney in mediation, after I feel like I've talked enough with my client and we're still in the breakout room, I offer to the client to get off the clock and do something else. And it's a lot easier to do when you're on Zoom.
Have any of you used a hybrid where maybe you have the majority of the sessions by Zoom, but you still have at least, you know, something in person to kind of get that face-to-face conversation either with the other side or with your client to help kind of really make sure everybody's on the same page?
I don't know if we're there yet with COVID. And we could have another wave of something. And I think COVID has been the big uncertainty throughout this process. We're almost getting to the point where I think that attorneys and clients may feel comfortable doing it in person, but there's that residual risk there. Mm-hmm. And there's risks to everyone, which needs to be taken seriously.
Liisa, in the collaborative cases I've had the last year and a half, we have tried to meet in person at the final session to sign the paperwork. It's just, there's something about putting your hand to pen rather than clicking a button on the computer that makes it more real and just feels better to be able to congratulate everyone and maybe give them a gift and whatever. So we try to get the last, at least my practice, I try to have the last signing session be live.
Got it. Thank you. And I do have one more question. I think Jim actually already answered it in his introductory remarks, but how to select your mediator, collaborative attorney, or your arbitrator? And Jim, like I said, I think you already answered it. So Veronique, do you have any advice for the audience about selecting the your mediator?
I think it's really important to be careful how you select your mediator. Like, you know, I mean, in Washtenaw County, you have sometimes mental health professionals who do mediation. I don't want, you know, or even attorneys who don't really seem to be that comfortable with financial matters. If you have complex financial issues, I think you want a mediator who will understand them, who understands how valuations work, and so on. On the other hand, if you have some difficult parenting time issue and custody issue, enlist a mental health professional to help mediate, and maybe the mediator takes care primarily of the financial issues, and the mental health professional tries to see if the parties can reach an agreement on the custody parenting time issue. So there's no reason you cannot have two mediators.
Okay, Randy?
Yeah, one of the big challenges in a collaborative practice is you can talk to your client, you can educate them, they decide, yeah, I'd like to at least investigate this collaborative process. And then you give your client a list of names and they see all red flags. Oh, they're just trying to get me into some attorney that doesn't know what they're doing and whatnot. And you can give a whole list of everybody who does collaborative in West Michigan, but there are some that I work better with than others. So I try to trim it down. But I find giving more rather than less sends a signal that I'm not trying to steer them to hire one particular person. But that's a challenge.
Got it.
Liisa,
I
want to comment that I think the personality fit is critical. And when I select a mediator, it's not by accident. It's because I'm looking at the personality of my client. I'm looking at the personality of the other party. And I want to find someone that both sides will buy into. And that's a very unique selection process. Mm-hmm. And that's really important to me, because if the case is going to settle, there has to be trust in the mediator and buy-in by both parties, not just one party.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
So I wanted to thank everybody for attending today, and especially to our three experts in ADR devices. We are probably going to circulate something in less than a week. That's just a little recap of today, probably with some of the statutes, so you don't have to try to listen to the audio again just to find the statutory site. And I will also try to circulate that collaborative form that Alyssa had mentioned, and anything else that our wonderful panelists want to make sure you guys know about. So again, thank you to all three of you. This has been wonderful, very informative, and you guys have a great rest of the day.
Terrific. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks to all the attendees.
Thank you, Liisa, for putting us together.
I just saved the chat, just so you know. I'm going to stop the recording. I just saved the chat.